And good morning and welcome to this week's edition of Salacious Crumbs. So on August 26th, Lucasfilm is re-releasing Rogue One, A Star Wars Story in select IMAX theaters to prepare fans for the September 21st premiere of Andor on Disney Plus. The film's special event will also include an exclusive look at the series. So if you want to see the first non-Skywalker saga film on the big screen again, check out your local listings. Now, we know that Kenobi was originally supposed to be a movie, but that got shelved. Ewan McGregor spoke a little about this more during a panel during Fan Expo Boston last Sunday, admitting that the story was supposed to be about him and Luke with a little Leia thrown in. However, there was a moment when everyone decided, no, let's do this instead, and changed it to simply Obi-Wan and Leia. Now, if they can just have that moment and decide to keep it to one season instead of more... McGregor also mentioned the sly return of Liam Neeson on the small screen in the final episode of Kenobi. He stated that Neeson is a hero of his and remembers watching him growing up and wanting to be an actor. Working with Neeson was an honor, building the relationship and being able to have him in this series and was just right. Now, StarWars.com has announced Marvel's Star Wars Revelations, a special one-off issue to set the course for future series. It will take place after The Empire Strikes Back and find Darth Vader seeking out the Eye of Webbish Bog on Mustafar, a mysterious creature strong with the Force. This tale will tease the direction Marvel's other series will go. It's written by Mark Guggenheim and illustrated by Salvador Larroca and Paco Medina, with the cover artwork by Phil Noto. According to Guggenheim, we know the Force can be used to glimpse the present, past, and possible futures. The eye will allow Vader to see all, including moments that will be in the 2023 storylines. This will be released in November. Now, Lucasfilm has also announced a pair of novels that will tie in Star Wars Jedi Survivor. Star Wars Jedi Battle Scars is the first and set in the 5 years between the events between Fallen Order and Survivor. It will see Cal Kestis with the Mantis crew embark on an epic adventure. It's written by Sam Maggs and will be released March 7, 2023. The art of Star Wars Jedi Survivor chronicles the development of the sequel and will feature concept art and creator commentary. This will be released May 2nd, 2023. Now, last month, it was announced that Star Wars Knights of the Old Republic had been put on an indefinite hold by Aspyr after firing their art director and design director, and the release time frame was up in the air. Now we have a promising new update, maybe. Eurogamer has shared that Embracer Group revealed in their Q1 interim report that one of its AAA games being developed by Aspyr has been moved to another studio within the group to ensure the quality bar is where we need it to be for the title. Now, the report did not state which project, but speculation does point toward Knights of the Old Republic remake. Embracer did state they didn't expect any material delays on this movement. However, now Jason Schreier, who wrote the original Bloomberg report that announced this delay, has taken to the Twitterverse to respond to fans. He posted this quote from PC Gamer, who ran an article with the title, "The Knights of the Old Republic Remake Might Still Be Coming This Year," in which he replied, "The Knights of the Old Republic Remake is absolutely not coming this year." His tweet got so many responses, including one implying that a 2024 release, in which Schreier rebuffed with, "Even 2024 is wishful thinking unless they park down the project." He then explains that he believes the lack of progress over the 2 years of development was the reason for the move, and that if anybody believes moving it without having a delay, well, he's got a Wookiee to sell to them. Rosario Dawson had a busy weekend at C2E2. Besides panels and meeting fans, she was inducted into the Rebel Legion by Illinois and Wisconsin-based Rebel Legion Nar Shaddaa base. It was presented by base commander at Life After Zul, who was joined by at Commander Pop-Tart and the Patty Chuck. After her panels, she joined them at their booth, chatted with their garrison and legion members with the Chicago D2D Droid Builders Club. During a panel at Fan Expo Boston, Ming-Na Wen did talk a little bit about the second season of The Book of Boba Fett. As she put it, second season of The Book of Boba Fett, I hope. I never count my chickens before they hatch because in this business, you just never know. But, knock on wood, they'll be announcing that soon. Who knows? Over at Fanboy Expo Knoxville, Christopher Lloyd responded to the rumor of his role in season 3 of The Mandalorian. And from the looks of it, Lucasfilm has gotten to him, too. When asked about it, he responded, "We were all sworn to secrecy, so I don't know." Well played, Doc. Reddit user Ahsoka's is back with the Acolyte rumors. This time, they state they have seen concept art of a planet with large snow-covered mountains alongside tall cities that have tentacle-type features and bell-shaped roofs. They say that it is similar to what we saw on Scipio in The Clone Wars, and are thinking that it is Scipio, which will be featured in The Acolyte. So why Scipio? Well, it's the home world of the Mun series, or species, excuse me, which is what Darth Plagueis is. It hasn't been confirmed that he will be making an appearance. Ahsoka does believe, though, he will be based on what they have seen. Star Wars Vision executive producer James Waugh spoke to Deadline about his vision for the second season. The first anthology was anime because Lucasfilm loves the style, but he wants to see it on a broader palette. Instead of recruiting studios exclusively from Japan, the second volume of the anthology series will incorporate studios from all over the world. Wan states he always wanted to represent Star Wars from a varied global perspective. He says Visions Volume 2 is sort of a global tour of some of the most interesting animation studios on a global level. We have studios from Africa, Chile, England, Ireland, France, India, and the guiding light there was that we wanted to tell their stories to be a reflection, or that wanted their storytelling to be a reflection of what Star Wars meant in their culture, but also as a reflection of the myths and stories that could only come out of their cultural context. The next installment is expected to be released in the spring of 2023. ComicBook.com spoke to Colin Trevorrow during an event for Jurassic World, and the subject of Star Wars came up. He says right now he won't be returning to that galaxy far, far away anytime soon. He's been doing work on these large franchises for a while, and the idea of a smaller story has more appeal. He says he did do a small film after Jurassic World, but the focus was he was the director of Star Wars when he did it. He'd like to step out of those shadows of these large films and do some work as himself. Now, everyone has criticism of something these days, and recently Mark Ruffalo put his two credits in, stating that with the MCU, the steady flow of content isn't a problem because Marvel Studios lets its talent recreate each piece in their own style, their own likeness. Whereas Star Wars projects have similar tones, basically, quote, "You're pretty much going to get the same version of Star Wars each time," which is something fans have complained about with being under Disney. Now, talking to Entertainment Weekly, Dave Filoni addressed this concern. He says, "We love seeing the development of all these series and how from the new show we're doing with John Watts, Skeleton Crew, but when you look at Andor, you look at Obi-Wan, you look at Mando, you look at Boba. They all do have a different feeling, a different tone, and I think that's remarkable and really speaks to the serialized nature of Star Wars and how it can be a very flexible galaxy. I mean, it is a galaxy, so there's going to be many stories to tell, and that's exciting. But I don't know yet. I'm waiting to see a little more as I put together what that tone becomes because it's evolving right now. It's evolving." Now, even Taika Waititi had a thing or two to say since he's been on both sides. He noted that Marvel and Star Wars have very different styles, but does admit that the tone of the first films should be adhered to since it is what fans like. It can't be disrespected. Filoni calls it a flexible galaxy. It has its own history and its own set of rules versus the MCU universe. Both have stories that are connected, but since Star Wars is a genre within itself, the multiple stories of the MCU allows it to try out different genres and styles. So, what do you think about these arguments? Who's right and who's right? Let us know in the comments. The Toy of the Year Awards are just around the corner, coming up in September 20th in Dallas, and this year's nominees include three Star Wars toys: Hasbro's LOLA-59, which is Lola, the animatronic edition, Leia's droid from Obi-Wan Kenobi, nominated for Action Figure of the Year; the Cal Kestis Legacy lightsaber hilt from Disney Consumer Products has a nod for Grown-Up Toy of the Year; and for Game of the Year, Star Wars Villainous Board Game from Ravensburger. You have till September 2nd to cast your vote at toysawards.com, and we'll have the link for that in our notes. Now, calling all Darth Revan fans, Hasbro has announced the return of Revan's lightsaber. The Black Series Force FX Elite Electronic Lightsaber is back and now available for pre-order. Inspired by the lightsaber from the Knights of the Old Republic game, the blade goes from red to purple, so you can choose which side you're on. The retail price will run about $280, and the lightsaber will be available in the spring of 2023. And if you were unable to get your own Black Series Bo-Katan Kurtz electronic helmet when it came out, now is your chance. Currently, it is 20% off over on Amazon. Hasbro's fully electronic helmet replica is wearable and based off the look of her armor from The Mandalorian. It includes electronic features like a drop-down rangefire, two red LEDs that flash in the hunting pattern, and a white LED illuminated heads-up display. Again, 20% off will cost you only $99. So get it while that sale does last, because you might need the extra money if you do this. I hope you're still saving for that trip to the Galactic Starcruiser, because it just got a little more expensive. According to Pirates and Princesses, they have heard that the portrait experience will be increasing from $99 to $399 beginning October 17th. 2022. Apparently, the $99 was just an introductory price. This 30-minute experience with a Disney Photo Pass photography will include, will make sure your group looks their galactic best and will take you to select locations. The session includes a consultation, pictures with reviews by specially trained cast members using advanced digital photography equipment and lighting, downloads of select images taken with the professional retouch before delivery. No-shows or cancellations within 24 hours will be fully charged for the price of that session. Now, with the quality of cell phone cameras these days, is it really worth paying that much for 30 minutes? And my next question is this: does that 30 minutes include the consultation, shooting, and all that put together? Or is that 30 minutes of actual shooting with a little bumper time on each? So that's what we got this week for you guys. You're all invited to join us on the Ranker Pit Tuesday nights at 8 p.m. Eastern, 7 p.m. Central here on Sci-Fi for Me TV. No idea what we're going to talk about or who may show up, but in the meantime, you can connect with us over on the socials. Salacious Crumbs is on Facebook and on Instagram, so make sure you hit that like button, and we'll have more Salacious Crumbs Star Wars news for you next week.
Copyright 2022 by Flaming Dog Media, LLC. All rights reserved. No portion of this program may be retransmitted without the express written consent of Flaming Dog Media. You're watching Sci-Fi for Me TV. Delivering the Multiverse since 2009.